want to take the time to welcome everyone that we have here today, and thank you for taking time out of our busy schedules and joining us so that we can get more information and knowledge as we talk about Marcus Garvey. This day, I wanted to welcome everybody to class number 4 of the Marcus Garvey Masterclass. We're going to kind of parallel the similarities and differences between Marcus Garvey and some of his contemporaries. When we get done, we're going to also, you know, parallel our program, which is the Power Triangle Unity Program and Freedom. And with that being said, we're asking everybody to sit back and, you know, try to learn something new out of this class today. And with that being said, I would like for everyone to extend their hands for a prayer of invocation. Okay, as we about our task of praying and ushering in the Holy Spirit, I ask everyone to breathe in and exhale out. As we breathe in, I'm asking you to inhale and take in all the goodness of the power of God. When you inhale, I'm asking you to take in the goodness of the Holy Spirit. When you exhale, let go of some of that negativity. When you exhale, let go of some of those destructive attitudes. Inhale and exhale. Inhale and exhale. Almighty God of the Black Nation, we thank you today for allowing us to be in your presence just one more time. We thank you for allowing us together as your servants in this liberation struggle. We ask that you send the spirit of unity, the spirit of brotherhood, and the spirit of urgency as we seek greater understanding tonight. We ask that you bless us and keep us strong. We ask for healing and blessings for our sick and shut in. We pray for strength for our members that are in need. We pray for strength for the families that have recently lost warriors. We just ask that you help us understand your will, O God, and to help us do your will each and every day. This prayer and all other prayers, I pray in the name of the revolutionary Black Messiah Jesus, as do the congregation. Ashe and amen. And I will turn it over to Dr. Warren. He was so excited. He's ready to jump on in there, y'all. But I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Warren now.
Good evening, all. And this is another exciting opportunity for us to be in conversation. This evening, this session really talks about the politics in our faith and really what does that mean. I do a lot of reading and I have 3 books that I'd like you to reference as we have this conversation. One is titled, When Did Jesus Become a Republican? And I raise that, a professor at the ITC, Interdenominational Theological Center, really raised that question. He said, how could you follow Jesus and not care about the poor? How can you follow Jesus and not care about, well, I'm going to expand that to say, and not care about the oppressed. So as you listen to this conversation about Marcus Garvey, Booker T. Washington, W.E. Du Bois, think about the context from which they did their work. The second book, equally as important, and it talks about the politics of Jesus. And that raises a different question. Was Jesus' mission political, spiritual, religious, physical, social, or psychological? I would argue it's all of the above. And of course, the ultimate is the spiritual. So as we listen to our speaker, our panelists today, this evening, please think through those 2 books. And of course, we can't have a reading without always recommending Black Christian nationalists.
Amen.
That's always a text that talks about our spirituality, our politics, our sociology, and our psychology. So as we listen thoughtfully to this evening's conversation, please think through those books and the topics that they raise. And that leads me to a very proud moment to not introduce, because I only can introduce someone who has not been known and done wonderful work around the world. But I'd like to present a dear brother and warrior, the Reverend Oswad Walker. And his bio is too long to read. I'm just going to highlight some things that I think are critically important. He is the associate editor of the Defender Network in Houston and a member, a proud member of the Shrines of the Black Madonna National Board of Pastors. He's been a lecturer at the University of Houston since 2004 in African American Studies. And authored not one, not two, not three, not even four, but five books. And I won't list them, but he's well published. Pastor Oswad is a graduate of the University of Texas in Houston, at Austin, and at Emory University College, Candler School of Theology. And I point that out because it's really important as we go through these institutions of higher education, particularly predominantly white institutions, we have to wrestle to maintain our identity. And as you will hear throughout this presentation, Pastor Oswad has absolutely maintained his identity and pushed forward so that we all can become conscious of who we are, where we are, and what we have to do. Oswad is also the editor and executive producer of Conscious Conversations, a weekly podcast that wrestles with the big issues and ideas of the day from a Pan-African perspective. Let us all take a moment and thank our speaker for what he's going to say, because I know it will be powerful. Pastor Oswad, please have your word.
Man, I'm waiting to hear from this dude that you're introducing myself, doctor, but I appreciate those words. What I really wanted to talk about, and I'll just share a few words, because I think the real meat of this will come as we break out and wrestle in small groups with different themes that arise from, you know, a focus on Marcus Mosiah Garvey. But you know, if my words had a theme, it would be focusing on the similarities and differences between Marcus Mosiah Garvey and his contemporaries. And I think, you know, it's important to note that there were other Pan-Africanists, there were other nationalists before Marcus Garvey came on the scene. Just like our beloved founder, the Honorable Reverend Albert B. Clegg Jr., Jeremoji Abebe Ojimon, was inspired and influenced by those who came before him, the same can be said of Garvey. One of those people was Martin Delaney. Martin Delaney, according to some, is the father of Black nationalism. And some scholars have credited Delaney with being the first person to publicly declare Africa for the Africans. You know, those words that we associate with Garvey. But Delaney, he traveled to Liberia, West Africa, to investigate the possibility of setting up a colony for Black people. You know, he came to the conclusion from personal life experiences and just from, you know, reading the signs of the times that there was no place in this country for Black people. So he was all about immigration, total immigration, Black folk getting the hell out of Dodge. He worked with Frederick Douglass and the North Star paper. I mention that because I just find it interesting that so many progressive sisters and brothers, so many nationalists, Pan-Africanists, have found themselves at one point or another working for the Black press, recognizing the importance of, you know, having control of an institution that speaks truth to power that tells it like it is from our perspective, whether it's talking about history or whether it's talking about current reality. And so he did that. But like I was saying, right around 1959, he led an immigration commission to West Africa, exploring possible sites for a new Black nation along the Niger River. He said, you know, as Black folk, we are a nation within a nation. Again, those terms that we hear later on down the line, our beloved founder used those same words, but he was using them back in the 1850s. We are a nation within a nation, and we must go from our oppressors. Martin Delaney died 2 years before Garvey was born, but certainly someone as well-read as Garvey was, knew of and was influenced by Martin Delaney. Another person, if we're talking about Garvey, we've got to talk about these folk who came before him, Edward Wilmot Blyden. according to some historians, this is the father of Pan-Africanism. And both Delaney and Blyden had personal experiences of being accepted by white institutions of higher education. And then when they show up and folk find out that they were Black, you know, the doors were slammed in their faces. And so they had these personal experiences of recognizing that, you know, this country was not going to recognize, honor, or respect Black personhood, Black humanity. Edward Wilmot Blyden, one of the reasons why he's considered the father of Pan-Africanism is because he had two incredible careers as a diplomat in two different West African nations, Sierra Leone and Liberia. But he would make trips, constant trips from the States to West Africa. And his mission was to bridge the gap. You know, he recognized that there was ignorance on both sides. He knew that Black folk in America had been brainwashed and niggerized and taught that Africa was a land of savages, a land of no history. And so he was on a mission to teach Black folk here that that was not true. And he knew firsthand from his experiences living in Sierra Leone and living in Liberia. But on the flip side, in Sierra Leone and Liberia and so many parts of West Africa, there was this view of Black folk in America being really not of us, because, you know, they were the ones that were enslaved. So they're not really our sisters and brothers. And so Edward Wilmot Blyden spent his entire life trying to bridge the gap, and saying decades before Dr. John Henry Clark, that basically the only difference between us is where the quote unquote slave ship eventually landed. But we are literally all the same people and all the same family. So it was Blyden who was trying to awaken this Pan-African consciousness in Black people. So again, another brother who certainly had to be an inspiration to Garvey. He died in 1912 before Garvey made it to the United States. But if we're going to talk about comparing Garvey's view of Pan-Africanism and self-determination and nation building with his contemporaries, well, the first one we have to look at, the one that, you know, historians, whenever they do finally talk about Garvey, you know, those 30 seconds that they give him, they bring up W.E.B. Du Bois, and, you know, rightly so. Du Bois was not only a national figure, but an international figure. In terms of Du Bois's views on moving Black people forward, he was for full U.S. citizenship. Du Bois was not only one of the most learned people in America, one of the most learned people on the planet. And so he knew, I think it was, you know, our forever first lady, Michelle Obama. She said, and I know I'm going to really destroy her quote, but she basically said, you know, I've been in the room with these supposedly big wig people from all over the planet, and they don't have anything on us at all. And that was Du Bois's perspective. He had been to the highest of the highest, quote unquote, Ivy League schools. He had sat in classes. He had these professors who were supposed to be the greatest minds, and he was the smartest one in the room. So his position was, you know, I'm not, it's not me that should be thankful for going to Harvard. Harvard should be thankful that I was there. He knew who he was and whose he was, so to speak. But because he had that experience, and because he fiercely believed in the equality of all humanity, it was that that was pushing him to focus on Black people gaining full U.S. citizenship. We're living here. It was our blood, sweat, and tears that literally built the country. And so full U.S. citizenship should be ours. And so his focus was on getting full voting rights, on tearing down all the walls of segregation so that we could be integrated into these institutions that we helped to build, whether they be educational, business, or otherwise. He was, but one misnomer about Du Bois is that he didn't find Pan-Africanism until later in life, when the United States, for lack of a better term, rejected Du Bois, and he repatriated to Ghana, where he lived out the end of his days. In 1900, Du Bois was a part of what some historians call the first Pan-African meetings on the planet, where you had leaders and intellectuals from various countries in Africa and various parts of the world. They met in London. They first called it a Pan-African conference. It was later they termed their group, their meetings, the Pan-African Congress. But Du Bois was there at the first one. But it wasn't until 19 years later that he revived this concept of this international gathering of Black men and women who were focusing on the plight of Black people all over the planet. It was not until 19 years later that he took this back up. But from that point on, every 2 years, there was an international meeting, a Pan-African Congress, 1919, 1921, 23, 25, 27. But I think it's important to note that you could argue that those conferences were way more intellectual than they were trying to figure out the nuts and bolts of liberation. You could argue that because, you know, the folk who gathered together, they would present papers. They would, you know, just like any conferences that, you know, that folk go to, there are those people that are presenting, they present a paper, they present a speech, they present this, that, and the other, they share ideas. This was kind of the tone and tenor of these conferences. And they got more and more focused on less and less intellectual and more focused on the nuts and bolts of changing the condition for Black people as the years went on. But they started out way more on the kind of ivory tower intellectual tip. And so this is what I see as one of the biggest differences between Du Bois's Pan-Africanism and Garvey's, because Garvey wasn't interested in, you know, just gathering a bunch of sisters and brothers around just to have conversations on the issues. He clearly knew what the issues were. He knew that Black people all over the planet, wherever he went, he knew the story was the same. And it was like a fire shut up in his bones, because he, like Du Bois and like so many others, knew that these folk who are oppressing us, you know, this is not of God. This is not because they are superior to us. It is simply because they have garnered that position And we have not organized sufficiently to change those realities. But I really just wanted to make that point about Du Bois, that he was at least thinking and discussing and meeting with leaders on Pan-African level for many, many years, well before he eventually went to Ghana. Another person to compare with Garvey was the person, one of the people that truly inspired him, Booker T. Washington. So inspired was Garvey by Booker T. Washington's work at Tuskegee. And, you know, we're talking about Tuskegee and Dr. Warren, that's where he literally is right now. I just love that fact, where my oldest daughter graduated, by the way, from Tuskegee. Yes, yes. But Booker T. Washington's focus on self-determination, on doing for self, on building for self, that was the thing that sold Garvey on Booker T. Washington's approach. So Booker T. Washington it is known in many circles for a speech he made in Atlanta that was later dubbed the Atlanta Compromise. Booker T. was the accepted Black leader. He was the leader that was accepted by white folk. And so he made a speech that he deemed was palatable to white ears. He talked about, you know, as a society, we can be as together as a hand, but as separate as the five fingers, where, you know, white folk are doing their thing and Black folk, we'll do our thing. We're not going to push for full integration. We're not going to get y'all pissed off and, you know, demanding voting rights. We're just going to, wherever we are, whether that's Tuskegee or wherever else, we're going to do our thing to maximize our skills so that we can be self-sufficient and so that we can earn your respect and earn your way into society. That's what Booker T said on the surface. But underground, Booker T. Washington was funding the very things that Du Bois had been talking about. Booker T. Washington was using those resources that he was able to access because he was a quote unquote accepted leader to fund the push and the movement for voting rights, the push for the end of segregation, all those things that Du Bois was fighting for, Booker T. Washington was actually funding. He just kept it on the low low. And so he was actually working both sides of the coin. But as I was saying, it was his focus on institutional power, his focus on self-determination. Those were the things that really attracted Garvey. Now, some contend, and they make a good point, that Booker T's focus of institutional power and self-determination was mainly focused on the United States. He didn't have the international focus, at least I haven't found the scholarship that suggests that he's talking about and envisioning a Pan-African reality. So his was mainly focused on the States, and that was a huge difference between him and Garvey, the brother that he inspired. But before I move away from Booker T, I think it's really important to note that Du Bois, for some reason, was just really up for the drama. He had a very public feud with Booker T. Washington because, as I said, Du Bois was for, you know, a liberal arts education, full integration, fighting for voting rights. You know, how dare anyone, you know, deny us full equal access to all the rights that we're supposed to have. And here Booker T. Washington saying, we're not going to fight for any of those. We're just going to chill and master our trades and, you know, just be so righteous and live with such integrity that one day you will recognize who we are. And so they did not get along. And Du Bois attacked Booker T for that position. But what I find, I don't know if the word is ironic, interesting, or whatever, Du Bois was one of those persons who was a part of that contingent that were members of the Niagara movement when the result of that was the founding of the NAACP. This group, the Niagara movement, they get their name because they were supposed to meet in Buffalo, New York to plan all this. But because of segregation, the Black folk that were part of that contingent weren't allowed in the institutions. And so everyone had to cross the Niagara and go into Canada so that they could have their meetings. And so while they couldn't even find a place to meet, and they're sticking their nose up about Booker T, but Booker T Washington had built an entire campus full of institutions. He could have had a meeting wherever the hell he wanted to because of the approach that he took that was different than WEB. Okay, but moving on, how is Garvey similar to and different than the founder of the Shrines of the Black Madonna, the Honorable Reverend Albert B. Clegg Jeremoji Abebe Ajimon? So many similarities when you look at how they were formed, how their worldviews were formed. Both of them were heavily influenced by their parents. Marcus by his mother, by his father, Marcus Sr., and his mother, Sarah. Fiercely influenced by their views of equality and their views of self-determination, and the fearless way they lived their lives. Garvey said that his father had made fortunes and had lost them. He was a man that was just brave and bold and fearless, willing to risk it all. He was considered the lawyer of the community because he had a huge library and was so well read. All these things fell upon Garvey and were evident in his life. His mother, they tell the story that she wanted to name him Messiah, literally Messiah, but she fell upon Mosiah as his middle name because she believed that he was going to do great things for Black people. So this was the context of his upbringing in his home. And then you look at our founder, and it's the same thing. Albert Clegg Sr. was that progressive doctor and leader who made those house calls and took his son with him. His mother, Pearl Reed Clegg, was the sister who would advocate not only for her children, but for other Black children to be protected from white teachers who were trying to damage their Black minds. And so it was that kind of fierceness that shaped and formed our beloved founder. And, as he says in the opening of Black Christian Nationalism, it was his mother that first told him that Jesus was Black and that his divinity teacher was wrong. Jesus was Black. So the influence of their parents, but they were both influenced by other nationalists who preceded them. They were both influenced by the big ideas of the time. And each were led to focus on institutional power. Power doesn't come simply because you have extra letters after your last name. It doesn't come to you because of how much money you have or don't have in your bank account. Power comes from institutions. And so both focused on building, forming, founding institutions. Another similarity, it can be found in the theology of the Pan-African Orthodox Christian Church. So much of the language we use to describe God literally came straight from Marcus Garvey. Garvey said many, many years ago, God is cosmic energy and creative intelligence. We use that same definition when we try to give words to the great I am. Garvey rejected I'll put it like this. So if you ask people right here, right now, who is the father of Black theology or Black liberation theology, you'll usually get two answers. Most folk will say Dr. James Cone. Some will say Reverend Albert B. Clegg Jr. Cone's most famous book was entitled God of the Oppressed. And Cone argues that God is on the side of those people who are mistreated and downtrodden and abused by society, that God will be there for those people. Our founder, like Marcus Garvey, rejected that idea. Garvey rejected that idea. He said, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said, God is not looking upon us favorably because we are being abused. God does not look upon us favorably because we are mistreated. The God I believe in gave Black people the same intelligence and creativity and power that God gave to all other human beings on the planet. So, if we find ourselves in a bad situation, it's not because, we are more blessed, and it's really not because of white folk. It's because of what we either do or don't do. And I'll be darned if our beloved founder literally said those exact same words. He just kind of massaged them differently. He said, God is more angry with us for accepting oppression than he is for whites for oppressing us in the first place. So both Garvey and our founder rejected this idea that just that we receive some kind of special layer of favor because we are being so abused and downtrodden. Now, Garvey and our founder believed that God endowed us with the same thing that God endowed everyone else with. But what are we going to do with that? What are we going to do with our Messiah potential, our cosmic energy, our inner divinity? How do we use that? That is what's going to show ourselves approved to our God. And just a couple of other things, and then we can jump on in to these breakout rooms. A huge similarity between Garvey and our beloved founder was the importance of the issue of authority. The issue of authority. And this is something that Black folk, we still need to figure out how to get right, because there are some Black people, even to this day, who sit back and wait for the people who are abusing us to then give us the okay in terms of how we protest that abuse. Is it okay to protest this way? Is it okay to protest that way? How the hell can you sit there and wait for the person that's beating you upside the head or has their knee on your neck? How are we, what sense does it make for us to then allow that person to tell us what's the best way for us to fight back? It makes absolutely no sense. And so both Garvey and our founder came to that same conclusion, that the only way forward is for us to have the audacity and the nerve and the courage to accept our own authority. We have got to be able to look at ourselves. When we look at ourselves in the mirror, when we look at our sisters and brothers, we have to be able to see the presence of the divine and know that that power is speaking to us and through us. And it's that authority that allows us to say which way we're going to go or what we're going to do. It's not the person that is trying to oppress and brutalize and exploit us to the nth degree that has the right to tell us which way we move forward. And then finally, if we're going to talk about a difference, I think the biggest difference between Garvey and our beloved founder was where they positioned the faith institution. And when you think about it, it's a big difference, but on some levels, not so much. The African Orthodox Church a lot of scholars make the mistake of saying that was a church founded by Marcus Garvey. It was not. It was a church founded by Bishop George Alexander McGuire, who was a member of the UNIA, Garvey's movement. It was the faith institution most closely associated with Garvey, most closely associated with the UNIA. Bishop McGuire wanted that faith institution to become the official faith institution of the Universal Negro Improvement Association. And it just made sense because Garvey was such a believer in the spirit. He was a Christian, unashamedly a Christian. But Garvey rejected the idea of having the African Orthodox Church as the official faith institution of the UNIA, and it caused a split between the brothers. Bishop McGuire left the movement for a little while. He later came back. But Garvey's thinking, certainly you can understand it. Garvey had 6 million members in the UNIA. Some practiced traditional African faiths, some were practiced Islam, some practiced Christianity and other faiths. And so in Garvey's calculus, he knew that if he made this Christian church the official faith organ of the UNIA, that would close the door for so many millions of members of his organization. So it only made organizational sense that he would reject that idea. Now, moving forward, when you get to our beloved founder and the situation of institutional powerlessness in the states, we learn in Black Christian nationalism, our founder said the only institution Black people own and control outright is the Black church. And from that institution can be birthed all the other power institutions that we need. And so from that perspective, it only made sense that he said, for a movement to be successful, there's got to be a church, not just any church, but a counterculture church, a church that is preaching new directions for the Black church. That's got to be foundation. And from that, all the other institutions can be birthed. And he's going on history because the first Black businesses in this country were birthed out of the church, the mortuaries and the insurance companies, benevolence offerings were born from those mutual aid societies that came out of the church. And so our founder was saying, that's where our power lies. That's the only, if power lies in institutions, that's the only institution we have. And so a church with new directions has to be the genesis for all those other institutions that we need. And so that was the biggest difference. But again, when you really think about it, is it a difference or not? Because they're both trying to figure out how can we access and influence the maximum number of Black people, Pan-African people on the planet. And I'll just end by sharing two quick thoughts and we can break up into groups. If you're going to talk about Garvey and you're going to talk about Cleve, or any Black folk, you have to bring up the issue of colorism. I remember, I don't know how many of y'all saw School Days when it came out. I remember having a conversation with a young lady about Spike Lee's movie School Days. And a big part of the movie, it deals with colorism within the Black race. And the young lady I was talking to said she didn't get it because she thought colorism was dead. That conversation that me and her had was in the late 80s. It's 2022 and Black folk are still dealing with the issue of colorism right now. And so you have to know that gave fuel to a whole lot of the animus and hate that Garvey received. When Garvey was growing his institution, his organization, Du Bois and others attacked him. Some literally used the language Garvey is nothing but a black monkey. They literally use that language, the same language that colonizers and oppressors used to deride black people. It was other black people that used that to describe Marcus Mosiah Garvey. And this short, kind of stocky, dark-skinned black man who's talking about up ye mighty race, accomplish what you will. And here you have Du Bois, which was exactly the opposite of that. Some would say his lighter skin made him more palatable to the larger society and to a whole lot of black folk. And so that had to be part of the fuel to the criticisms and the attacks upon Garvey. But I would also throw in, and I don't know the correct term, I know Dr. Warren will correct me. I just call it geography-ism. I don't know the term, doctor, so please help a brother out. But because Garvey was from the West Indies, was from the Caribbean, people tried to undercut his credibility, saying, oh, he's not from the United States. And so why should we be listening to him? Which I find insane, because if you look at the leadership, the movers and shakers of the New Negro Movement, the Harlem Renaissance, it was literally one out of three of those sisters and brothers were themselves from the West Indies. Claude McKay and so many others had West Indian Caribbean roots, yet they were all going in on Garvey because he was not born in the United States, as if that meant his voice did not matter and we should not be listening to it. And that's really the conclusion of the comments I had. But I think it's important for us to have these discussions because none of us exist on an island. We have those folk who have inspired us. We have those who disagree with us and, we have to duck and dodge and fight back, but that colors so much of how we live our lives and how we move through this thing called life. And so I'm going to go ahead and turn it back over to Sister Reverend Chakaysha and Reverend Warren, and y'all can direct us as we're going to go from here.
Thank you so much. Let's give the brother a hand. I hope you've heard something that you have heard before, and surely something that you haven't heard. I think this point in our session, we're going to have some breakout rooms to really wrestle with some of the things that Pastor was talking about. So at this point in time, we're going to go to our breakout rooms, and then we'll come back and have a more fluid and genuine conversation.
I hope that we all had meaningful discussions in our breakout rooms, and we've gone about 15 minutes past our closing time, but we would be remiss if we did not ask our presiding bishop if he has any remarks before we close.
No, I don't have any remarks. I think everything was good. I experienced the SWOD's presentation, which he did pretty masterfully. And our discussion in our particular group was a healthy discussion. I think the thing that we came to basically is that although people had differences, they were all trying to do something for Black people. And so therefore their contribution ought to be respected and acknowledged. And the differences of opinion about how to get things done, it's always going to happen anywhere, in any organization or family or church or anything else. But the thing is that they were all committed to the liberation of Black people, and they were trying to do it from the perspective that they could understand. That is what we need to focus on, not arguing about the differences between the two and being divided up in one camp or another. They were all trying to move the dial for Black people, and to that we should say amen and I share.
Amen.
Yes. Reverend Yonu, this is Karima. I just wanted to make you aware that the end time for this session is 8:30. It's half past the hour, so we do have a few minutes to discuss, and if you have to leave, it's okay. But We do have minutes for the teams to share if they'd like to.
All right. Our discussion was very meaningful. And I want to ask Brother Shamar, if he doesn't mind, kind of summarizing the conversation that we had.
I think we have very fruitful discussion, and people talked about some of their experiences around this question of colorism and how when some dark-skinned people had real problems growing up and we internalized that kind of oppression, the value of our oppressor and giving us the value of beauty, you know, light skin, whether your nose is too broad, or your African lips are too full, or your coarse hair. And once we fight against cultural imperialism and begin to internalize, so the discussion I thought was great. The examples that people experience themselves, I think was very good. And we also understood that we can't get lost in that discussion because as we fight against colorism, we got to fight against the system of capitalism and the other kinds of things that's oppressing us and not get lost in that. And then some of the harsh things that we say to each other, you know, around that question. I thought some of the personal experiences that people had was excellent coming from our group and just laying out the impact that that has had on people in the past and is still presently impacting, you know, our families. And sometimes our families, one person brought up the fact that their family used to get into that. And I was telling them I'm not that dark, but I was considered the black sheep of my family. So because everybody else was lighter, but it was balanced off because I used to argue with some sisters that thought I was cute. And when I became conscious, you just think I'm cute because I got light eyes like the white man. So I said, wait a minute, Charles, don't be dissing yourself. If they think you're cute, take it. But so, you know, we had, I think, a very fruitful discussion on some of the impact that colorism can have on our families and on us as individuals. And you did a very good job facilitating us.
Well, thank you for the compliment and for the summary. Appreciate it. Reverend Warren or Reverend Chakasha, would you like to speak about what your groups did?
Yes, we had the question, why did W.E.B. Du Bois call Marcus Garvey the most dangerous enemy of the Negro race in America? Reverend Dejanaba, would you want to speak on some of the things that we discussed in the meeting, in our breakout session?
Well, I think, you know, basically, you know, we had a really good discussion. We were talking about, you know, when he talked about Marcus Garvey being dangerous to Black people, we said the only danger was that he was waking us up to see the reality that we lived in, that he appealed to the masses of Black people, and that once you know the truth, you are going to be dangerous to a system that's trying to oppress you. You know, you're going to want to get up and do things for yourself. You're going to say that I have the power, that you can't deny me the what is rightfully mine. And so waking up millions of Black people would be a danger to those who are trying to maintain the status quo. But it also, you know, it was stated that he was not dangerous in our eyesight. He was a godsend. He helped us to realize what we needed to do in order to recognize our power and the divinity that's within us.
Well, you know, there's another side of that question. And I'll just state it very briefly. Both Carter G. Woodson and W.B. Du Bois went to Harvard, where the eugenics movement was at its height. And one of the things that was commonly talked about while they were in school was the extermination of Black people, mm-hmm. to remove Black people from the gene pool so they would not possess a threat to everybody else. So they could have thought that Garvey was dangerous because it might be inviting them to move on their final solution, as opposed to trying. Carter G. Woodson wrote history to prove the worth and value and contributions of Black people so that that would not be a solution. And W.B. Du Bois was trying to build bridges so that would not be a solution. So they weren't just motivated by Negro thinking. They had very real concerns about the dangers that the dangers that a nationalist movement presented to Black people.
And if I would just like to add, I thought one of the unpardonable sins of W.E.B. Du Bois and others is when they joined with J. Edgar Hoover to actually prosecute
Marcus Garvey.
Yeah, we could have differences, but come on, you can't be joining the enemy. Was that jealousy? Was that because he swept up all of the African working class masses and Cyril Briggs and the African Blood Brothers? They couldn't do it. The communists couldn't do it. The socialists couldn't do it. A. Philip Randolph couldn't do it. Marcus scooped them all up. And they went after him with the FBI.
Yep, it sure is.
That's a bit much.
And on the other side, Marcus Garvey met with segregationist white nationalist organizations, including the Klan. He did that to secure stuff for Black people. Since they wanted to be segregationists, he said, "I'll go along with your segregation program as long as we get a place in Africa where we can build our own government, and we expect you to help us be able to do it." So what I'm trying, in all of this, everybody is pursuing a strategy that they believe is going to benefit Black people. And when we get in these ideological camps, it you turn the other person that thought about doing it a different way into the devil, as opposed to they had a difference of opinion. And when you look at it, both things contributed to our present status in the country. Mm-hmm. And it's not a Malcolm X or Martin Luther King thing. Both of their positions were important in terms of securing some position for us in this country. So we got to be sophisticated enough to understand that you can go about the same thing different ways. And you don't have to turn into enemies over it.
Right.
Yeah, I would agree that it's not necessary to, but we should not make enemies out of Black people who may have a different philosophy or strategy. But one thing that is very clear for Black liberation is building and maintaining our own institution. And so that's the only thing that's really going to liberate Black people. Some of the other strategies may pave some potholes or do some things that will make living in America a little easier. But ultimately, if we're not building and maintaining our own institutions, then we're always vulnerable to white people in one degree or the other.
Self-determination is certainly the foundation. It's the final word in the whole thing, being able to determine our own destiny.
This is Elder Brown, Takuma. I just want to ask the question because everyone hit on something that I thought of earlier in this conversation. Has the leadership of our church or a PAOCC considered having a national conference with the present day leaders of these different movements to come together and dispel some of the myths that may be about them, for them to present their present day platform, if you will. And then at the end of the conference, if you will, maybe draw some conclusion that we don't all exist and have the same way of doing the same thing, and then come together, find out what we do similarly as Black people for our independence. I'm sort of floating around with this. I haven't got it all put together, but I think that there's a lot going on with different organizations. You got the Sankofas, and you got the Black Hebrew Israelites, and you got, all the different organizations. I think if they all came together at the table and just kind of sit down as brothers, sisters, and had a discussion about who they are, and then conclude where can we all go together. The bottom line is that there has to be a place, something that we can do and work together on. That's just my thought. So I hope somebody can better articulate what I'm trying to say.
The Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference tries to do that every year. That brings all of us as Black folk, both the leadership side and also the other side together to really talk about how can we benefit as a group. So that comes together every year. So they're doing what you're saying, Elder.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of room for functional unity. We can come together around those things that we all agree on in terms of feeding Black people, housing Black people, providing the necessary health and resources just for the maintenance of Black families, irregardless of what your political ideology might be. I think those are some foundational things that we can all agree on.
Yeah, because I'm looking at this, we were in a breakout. Everybody's not a carpenter, everybody's not a dentist, everyone's not a mechanic, everyone's not a preacher. But we all have we have skills. And I think that I feel it, that there's some way that we can come together and do something similar to what the Million Man March was supposed to try to accomplish. Anyway, I'm finished with.
Okay, and I'm sorry, that is such interesting stuff that you all are talking about, but we're probably going to get kicked out, and we do need to have a prayer of benediction to send everybody away in peace and in the spirit of God, okay? So, and if they don't cut us off, we can talk more after that, okay? If everyone would extend their hands for a prayer. And we just ask that everyone, as you leave here tonight, that we're all on one accord and of the same mission, one aim, one God, one aim, one destiny. Almighty God of the Black Nation, we thank you for allowing us to worship in your name. We ask that as we leave this space, we take with us everything that you wish us to do, never allowing us to forsake you, because you told us you would never forsake us. Help us to continue being a beacon of light for our people. These prayers and all others, we pray in the name of the revolutionary Black Messiah, Jesus. Amen. Amen.